For the past couple of minutes, it has been clear from this space back on Chambers in that area. So now they're walking back toward the World Trade Center. And as we keep letting you hear the personal stories, the survivor stories of exactly what happened inside the World Trade Center when that first plane went in, and of course the collapses since then, we're going to bring more of those to you now. Barry Jennings, you're on the 8th floor. You work for the City Housing Department. Explain to me the moment of impact.
Well, me and Mr. Hesch, the Corporation Counsel, were on the 23rd floor. I told him we got to get out of here. We started walking down the stairs. We made it to the 8th floor. Big explosion. Blew us back into the 8th floor. And I turned to Hesch. I said, this is it. We're dead. We're not going to make it out of here. I took a fire extinguisher, and I bust the window out. That's when this gentleman here heard my cries for help. This gentleman right here, and he said, kept saying, stand by, somebody's coming to get you. They couldn't get to us for an hour because they couldn't find us.
You thought that was it?
I thought we're dead. I thought that was it. I started praying to Allah. I said, that's it. We're gone. It's over.
What was it like for you? You were inside there as well.
It was pandemonium. I mean, it was something like out of a Bruce Willis Die Hard movie. He was there, and he was crying, and there was another gentleman crying and for help. We couldn't get to him. We tried to get through we went through the buildings. We were lost. Both staircases, the backside was completely blown away. There was no way to access us. We couldn't get to them. And finally, one of the fire department teams found them. But we didn't think they were going to make it.
Well, certainly you got out. Many others didn't, of course. We don't have a number right now of fatalities or injuries. But I want to translate a story to you that another man told me. He was near the building. He was on the lobby level, near the shopping area, near the promenade. The elevator doors, he said to me, blew open. And when the doors opened, there was a man on fire inside that elevator. That is the kind of tragedy we are talking about here, and where the World Trade Center.
Hi, my name is Barry Jennings. I'm 52 years old. I've worked for 33 years at one location. Basically, like I said, I'm married, father of four.
Why don't you tell people your experience from the very beginning of the day on September 11, 2001?
All right, it was, as I told you guys before, it was very funny. I was on my way to work, and traffic was excellent. I received a call that a small Cessna had hit the World Trade Center, and I was asked to go and man the Office of Emergency Management at the World Trade Center 7. On the 23rd floor. As I arrived there, there were police all in the lobby. They showed me the way to the elevator. We got up to the 23rd floor. Me and Mr. Hess, who I didn't know was Mr. Hess at the time, we got to the 23rd floor. We couldn't get in. We had to go back down. Then security and police took us to the freight elevators where they took us back up, and we did get in. Upon arriving into the OEM EOC, we noticed that everybody was gone. I saw coffee that was on a desk. Still, the smoke was still coming off the coffee. I saw half-eaten sandwiches. And only me, Mr. Hess, was up there. After I called several individuals, one individual told me that to leave and leave right away. Mr. Hess came running back in and said, we're the only ones up here. We got to get out of here. He found the stairwell. So we subsequently went to the stairwell, and we're going down the stairs. When we reached the sixth floor, the landing that we were standing on gave way. There was an explosion, and the landing gave way. And I was left there hanging. I had to climb back up, and now I had to walk back up to the eighth floor. After getting to the eighth floor, everything was dark. It was dark, and it was very, very hot. Very hot. I asked Mr. Hess to test the phones as I took a fire extinguisher and broke out the windows. Once I broke out the windows, I could see outside below me. I saw police cars on fire, buses on fire. I looked one way. The building was there. I looked the other way. It was gone. I was trapped in there for several hours. I was trapped in there when both buildings came down. The firefighters came. They came to the window, because I was going to come out on the fire hose. I didn't want to stay there any longer. It was too hot. I was going to come out on a fire hose. They came to the window and they started yelling, do not do that. It won't hold you. And then they ran away. See, I didn't know what was going on. That's when the first tower fell. When they started running, the first tower was coming down. I had no way of knowing that. Then I saw them come back. Now I saw them come back with more concern on their faces. And then they ran away again. The second tower fell. So as they turned and ran the second time, the guy said, don't worry, we'll be back for you. And they did come back. This time they came back with 10 firefighters. And they kept asking, where are you? We don't know where you are. I said, I'm on the north side of the building, because when I was on the stairs, I saw north side. Excuse me. All this time, I'm hearing all type of explosions. All this time, I'm hearing explosions. And I'm thinking that maybe it's the buses around me that were on fire, the cars on fire. I don't see no, you know. But I'm still hearing these explosions. When they finally got to us, and they took us down to what they called the lobby, because I asked them, I said, when we got down there, I said, where are we? He said, this was the lobby. And I said, you got to be kidding me. It was total ruins. Total ruins. Now, keep in mind, when I came in there, the lobby had nice escalators. It was a huge lobby. And for me to see what I saw, it was unbelievable. And the firefighter that took us down kept saying, do not look down. And I kept saying, why? He said, do not look down. And we were stepping over people. And you know you can feel when you're stepping over people. They took us out through a hole that I don't know who made this hole in this wall. That's how they got us out. They took us out through a hole, through the wall, to safety. As they were taking me out, one firefighter had fallen. I believe he was having a heart attack. But before that, this big, giant police officer came to me. And he says, you have to run. I said, I can't run. My knees are swollen. He said, you're going to have to get on your knees and crawl in. He said, because we have reports of more explosions. And that's when I started crawling. And I saw this guy fall behind me. And his comrades came to his aid. They dragged him to safety. I was looking for an ambulance for my knees. And at that time, they told me, we got to walk 20 blocks to refuge. Before I got there, Eyewitness News grabbed me and started interviewing me. That's basically it.
Now, real quick, I'd like, if possible, for you to elaborate on, now, you originally said on ABC 7 that you got to the 8th floor, and that's where the explosion was, and that's what blew you off. And there you said you got down to the 6th floor.
Well, it was the 8th floor we got back into.
Okay.
The 6th floor is where we got down to.
Okay, so you made it all the way down from the 23rd floor
to the 6th floor. Right, that's when the explosion happened.
Now, where did that originate from? Did the explosion come from under you?
It was definitely under us.
It was from under you.
It definitely was under us.
Now, did it lift you up? Is that?
Yeah, it blew us back, and then I found myself, I thought I was on a stair landing, uh-huh. But I wasn't. I found myself hanging on. Uh-huh. So you want me to go into that?
If you could.
Yeah,
sure,
yeah.
Sure.
It was pitch black. You couldn't see anything.
Right, right.
If you could please elaborate on that.
Sure.
Just quickly.
Okay, when I made it to the 6th floor, and there was an explosion. The explosion was beneath me. Mm-hmm. Keep in mind now, it's pitch black in there. All the lights went out.
Yeah.
So when the explosion happened, it blew us back. I'm thinking I'm standing on the landing. I'm actually holding on to a pole above us.
Really?
And I had to climb back up because Hess is yelling, what do we do now? I said, there's only one thing we can do, and it's go back up. So that's when we went back up to the 8th floor, and I busted out that window.
My other question was going to be, you said that you'd worked in the Office of Emergency Management since its inception in 99. Could you just tell people what the OEM was and your experiences with it, like how often you would be there, what the job of the OEM was?
Okay.
Excellent.
When the Office of Emergency Management did an activation, they always included our locale. And what they did was monitor the emergency. They actually coordinated the emergency through several agencies. And that's what we did. We were there as part of one of my agencies, which I can't name.
Of course.
And we would sit there and we would do SIT reports. We would get updates as far as the emergency that was on hand. And that's simply what we would do. Every agency that was involved in that emergency was there.
Okay. And that was manned 24 hours, I've heard?
When the activation, only when there was an emergency activation was that manned 24 hours. Okay. OEM was manned 24 hours without the activation. When they opened up the OE, the EOC, that was activated for as long as the emergency was going on. Once the emergency was subsided, then they would, you know, they would stand down.
Okay. My other question was, they had a drill in preparations called Tripod. Did you know anything about Tripod that was down at the pier at all?
Yes, okay. I was part of that.
Are you a part of Tripod?
Yes.
Discuss that at all?
Yeah, yes.
Can you discuss any aspects of Tripod?
Well, the only thing I remember is Tripod was, we did a drill which was supposed to be a man-made disaster, a terrorist attack, and it was supposed to be some kind of chemical. And all they did was drill. They went through the whole steps of what you would do here, if you'd come here, how you would, you know, they went through the whole thing.
Yeah.
And we were just part of, we were just viewing it. We were just part of the viewers.
Okay.
That was it. We wasn't part of the actual, we would just view the individuals.
And from media reports, we've heard that it was supposed to take place on the 12th, but preparations were before that. In other words, throughout the week, they've been manning the separate stations. Do you know when it was actually, like, in progress? Because you said you'd been part of it and seen it. So obviously, there was something going on before the 12th. Like, did you observe this in, like, the 10th, the 11th, like, right prior to 9/11?
No.
No, this was after?
Yes. Our participation was after.
Was after 9/11?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Then can you just give us permission to use it? Say louder than words, can you use this footage?
Yes, you can use this footage.
All right.
But real quick, I'd like for you to elaborate on a few things.
Sure.
What time approximately did you arrive at World Trade Center 7? I'm just trying to establish a timeline.
I received the call shortly after the first plane hit, which everyone thought was a Cessna. That's what I was told, a small Cessna lost its way and hit the plane. I got there, I had to be inside on the 23rd floor when the second plane hit.
Okay.
I was inside when the second plane hit. I was already in the World Trade Center 7.
Okay. You didn't hear that after the fact, or did you hear that when it happened? The second plane, when it hit?
I couldn't tell you because I was inside and I was like closed off from everything. Keep in mind now, OEM, the biggest, that big center, they had big, gigantic TV screens. And at that point, none of them were working. So I didn't know what was going on the outside.
So the building was essentially deserted when you and Mr. Hess, the command center was deserted when you and Mr. Hess got up there?
Yes.
Was that normal?
No.
No?
No.
Okay.
No, not at all. The word we got was they had to take the mayor and evacuate.
Mm-hmm. So they said that the mayor was in World Trade Center 7 that day?
Yes.
He was there earlier in the day,
yes.
And then evacuated.
Yes.
Could you say that, because we're not mic'd, can you say that Giuliani was in the building?
I didn't actually see him, but that's what I was told. That's why Hess was there.
Okay.
He was there to meet with Giuliani.
Okay.
That's about all I've got, Dylan.
No, I know. I just feel like there's something I'm missing. What's your impression with Building 7 and your experience in working there? What kind of vibe did you get from that building? You know that there was the CIA there, obviously. There was the Department of Defense. The Secret Service was there.
IRS
was there.
Well, I'm just confused about one thing and one thing only. Why World Trade Center 7 went down in the first place. I'm very confused about that. I know what I heard. I heard explosions. The explanation I got was it was the fuel oil tank. I'm an old boiler guy. If it was a fuel oil tank, it would have been one side of the building. When I got to that lobby, the lobby was totally destroyed. It looked like King Kong had came through it and stepped on it. And it was so destroyed, I didn't know where I was. And it was so destroyed, they had to take me out through a hole in the wall, a makeshift hole that I believe the fire department made to get me out. Me and Mr. Hess out.
I do have one more question.
Sure.
Did you ever talk to people from the 9/11 Commission, the Congressional Report, FBI, NIST, anybody? You did speak with them.
Yes.
Who did you speak with?
They called me down.
Which ones?
They were doing, I think it was part of the 9/11 Commission.
So okay. Was it the hearings at the new school?
No.
No?
No. I can't tell you where it was because...
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's right.
But they called me down there, and they asked me the same questions that you guys are asking. And at that point, they said, okay, thank you. and they sent me on my way.
And yeah, you told them pretty much everything you just told us.
Yes.
That you were in the building, got rocked by an explosion, yes. All that.
Yes.
And you know that they didn't mention Building 7 once in the commission report.
I told them that's where I was.
No,
that's
I know,
where
but,
I was.
But you know that they didn't mention the building at all.
I didn't, you know, I didn't give it too much thought. I thought they were just doing an into report or an investigation on as to what happened. They got my point of view, and I haven't heard any more from them.
All right, excellent. So you don't feel that you've gotten a satisfactory explanation for what happened inside that building?
No.
Not at all?
The explanation that I got was a fuel oil tank. No.
No.
So I heard the explosions, and then the key thing was. When the police officer came to me, he said, "We got reports of more explosions, so you have to run."
Uh-huh.
Big talk.
And that's after both towers had fell, correct?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, to your recollection, did the explosion on the sixth floor happen before the first tower collapsed, or the second one, or before both of them? Because I remember you said earlier you were actually trapped when both of them came down.
I'm still in the building when both of them came down.
You're still in the building. Are you trapped? On the sixth floor when the buildings came down?
Yes. Yes. Yes.
So it's safe to say that that explosion on the sixth floor happened before either tower fell?
It definitely happened before either tower fell, and I'll tell you why.
Barry, I'm sorry. Can you just wait for that chopper?
Sure.
Because this is vital. Because the whole official story, the whole reason that Building 7 collapsed, allegedly, is because the North Tower fell onto it and caused damage. And what people are going to say is they're going to say, well, Barry was hit by debris from the North Tower.
No. What happened was, when we made it back to the eighth floor, as I told you earlier,
yes,
both buildings were still standing because I looked one way, looked the other way. Now there's nothing there. When I got to the sixth floor before all this happened, when I got to the sixth floor, there was an explosion. That's what forced us back to the eighth floor.
Okay.
Both buildings were still standing. Keep in mind, I told you the fire department came and ran. They came twice. Why? Because building tower one fell, then tower two fell. And then when they came back with all concern now, like, to get me the hell out of there. And they did. And we got out of there. I got in the building way before, a little before nine, a little after nine. I didn't get out of there until like one.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Because the news report with Michael Hess was approximately around 1 p.m.
Mm-hmm.
Man, Barry, is there anything else you want to say? I mean, is there anything you want to clear up?
Well, you know, I like to say that, you know, my mind is still there. You know, that day I'll never forget. And the explanations that were given to me is totally unacceptable. Totally unacceptable. Because as I stated, I was there. I lived it. I lived through it. Actually, I thought I was going to die that day. Because me and Michael Hess did get on our knees and start praying when we saw that there was nobody coming, there was no hope. We did get on our knees and start praying. And then there was a fireman that shined the light and says, "Anybody in here?" Those are the sweetest words I ever heard. Is there anybody in here? And I, at that time, I told Mike, I said, "Mike, you better get under the desk and pray to who you're going to pray to, because I'm going to pray to who I'm going to pray to, because it doesn't look like we're going to make it." And that's when that fireman came and saved our lives.
And you got out of the building around 1 o'clock, and that's when you pretty much crawled out on your knees, and that's when ABC 7 caught you, right?
Yes, yes, yes.
And there's really been no official follow-up with you, right? I mean, obviously the 9/11 Commission invited you to come testify, and that was it. I mean, you never heard anything back from them?
No, no. I mean, I got several calls from several news reporters, and News 12 did come out to my home and interview me as far as what took place, but that was it. That was it. And it wasn't until some years later that I testified in front of them. To tell you, it was very scary because they looked like very important people.
Yeah.
They were questioning me about certain things. And I don't know if they liked the answers I gave. I could care less. I gave my account of it, the truth, and that was it.
When did you first start doubting? Well, did you have your doubts that day as to why? Well, did you even see Building 7 come down at all? But you were probably way gone by that.
No, I was long gone by then.
When did you first hear it collapsed?
And to my surprise, I was back in the office. secretaries and things that were cleaning me up. I was disheveled. I even started crying because of, you know, the lives that were lost, and I was lucky enough to get out of there. When I got home, I sat down in front of the TV, and my wife said, "Why do you keep watching this? Why do you keep?" I couldn't stop watching it, and that's when I found out Building 7 came down. I was so surprised, and I'm saying to myself, "Why did that building come down?" And I knew why it came down, because of the explosions. And it was not no fuel oil tanks.